SSH Tunneling. That was the topic of our previous episode of Friday Minis, and I don't blame you if you are a little bit confused about what exactly is going on in that particular episode. After all, not everyone does remote monitoring and control of headless devices. So let's break down exactly what's happening in that particular video, what are the concerns that got us to that point where we require SSH tunneling, and yeah, let's just try and have a better understanding of what it means to do this kind of stuff. The good news is, each individual concept is quite simple. It's just that there are quite a few of them and you need to piece them together in a way that sort of makes cohesive sense. So in this video, I'm going to try and do that for you. So yeah, with that said, let's go ahead and jump into today's Random Wednesday episode. Hello and welcome back to another Random Wednesday episode. I admit, today's video is going to be kind of scattershot because we're going to be covering a lot of tiny little concepts here and there. So don't be afraid to pop open the video description and jump ahead if I talk about anything that you think you're familiar with. But having said that, this is a contents page for what we're going to do today. Today's video comes to you in three parts. First and foremost, we're going to be talking about networking and remote access. What does it mean to have a remote device? What does it mean to be able to, well, connect to it and control it? Then we're going to be talking about servers, in particular server applications, and what it means for a server application to expose itself to, well, the network or just on its own local interface. We are of course going to be looking at the pros and cons of doing that and what it entails, and that allows us to transition nicely into talking about tunneling, which will help us mitigate some of the concerns. So these are the three main topics. Of course, each topic will have smaller parts. So again, feel free to skip ahead if you want to. But with that said, let's jump into our first part. First and foremost, let's talk about networking and remote access. Now, chances are at home, you're on a home network. You have multiple devices, right? You have your desktop or your laptop, you have your phones, you have your tablet, and of course, if you have other people in the same space connecting to the same router, then, well, they are on the same network as you. So networking is something that we experience in our day-to-day lives. But the thing is, chances are, it's unlikely for these devices to directly communicate with each other. Most of the time, these devices just go straight on to net. But having said that, there are quite a few use cases in which it makes sense for these devices to communicate directly with each other through the local network. And probably the most relatable one for us as end users is the notion of LAN gaming. LAN gaming, of course, refers to playing games with each other on a local network, so it is a multiplayer game, but it's not going online. Everything's happening at home. For that to work, essentially the computers need to communicate directly with each other. Of course, the lines are kind of blurred these days. You may have some elements of your gaming session that still goes online, even if you're playing with people in the same household, but that's another discussion altogether. The point is, there are use cases in which local computers communicating with each other do make sense. Then we move on to more advanced users. The thing is, you may, at certain points of time, want to set up a local server. One good example of this is if you have a network attached storage, or NAS. When you have a NAS like that, essentially what you're doing is you have a dedicated computer that has one or more hard drives installed, and this works as a network storage. So perhaps everyone in your household can back up their files to the same server. Your server may even have some kind of redundancy that, well, allows you to guard against drive failure, let's say. Well, that's a server that runs on the local network. It never goes online, at least not for its actual operations. For a device like that, it is also possible that you're running it in what we call headless mode. What that means is, despite the fact that this device is essentially a computer, you can actually connect a monitor, a keyboard, and a mouse to it, you may not actually get around to doing that. This computer could just run standalone without any interface, essentially. You can imagine that for something like a file server, that is how you would operate it on a day-to-day basis, right? You don't specifically need to have, you know, a keyboard and a mouse hooked up to it all the time. But there'll be times where you want to actually get into the server and, say, configure things, tweak things up, and so on. so you'll still want some way of accessing that device. Of course, it makes the most sense to do this over the network, right? That means that you can just use another device, you don't have to physically be present at the location of the server before you can actually tweak it up or control or monitor whatever. You can do it in the comfort of wherever your desktop is. So yeah, doing this over the network makes the most sense. There are many ways in which you can do this. What some of these devices do is they expose a server. So all you have to do is to get into your web browser, type in a password, and you can start administrating it. This essentially is how a lot of routers in our homes actually work. However, depending on what application it is, this may not give you enough control. You may want to actually get into the full desktop environment that the server device actually provides. And in order to do this, you essentially need to go deeper. Again, there's some alternatives as well. VNC is a popular one in which you can actually see the device desktop and you can remotely control it. So it's like you're working with that computer, except remotely over the network because you're sitting at a different computer. So that's nice as well. But the key thing we want to talk about today is SSH. These provide a nice middle ground because for VNC, you can imagine that a lot of data is being transferred. After all, you're seeing the desktop image. In cases where we want quicker control or potentially less data transfer, we can use a service like Telnet or SSH. Telnet is the traditional way in which we do it. The idea is you connect to the device and you get a command line view of essentially the device itself. From there, you have full command control, right? You can essentially delve through your files, run programs, change configuration, and so on. One drawback with Telnet, however, is the fact that it is not encrypted. What that means is, yeah, it's technically not very safe. Someone could tap into your connection, and generally that's bad. So we bridge that gap by using SSH, Secure Shell Host. SSH is essentially the same concept as Telnet. The difference being that the connection is actually encrypted, so there is a key exchange and, yeah, generally things are secure. So yeah, as long as you verify keys, you switch out the default password, you'll be fine. And that is basically remote administration in a nutshell. With SSH, you now have control in a secure manner over your remote device. So with that background out of the way, we can now talk about servers. Now, we've briefly mentioned something like a network attached storage, a NAS, which allows us to, well, communicate with the device over the network. That is essentially a server. It's a program that is, well, listening for network connectivity and essentially providing a service over the network by responding to these requests. So of course, a NAS is an example. Another example may be a web server. So for all the demonstrations we're going to be using in this video, I'll use a web server. But yeah, the idea is it's a program, it's listening for network connections, and it's responding to them, and of course, in doing so, providing a service. But here's the idea. In order for a server to be at all useful, you need to allow a remote device, or potentially even the same device itself, to connect to the server application. Of course, generally, we like to expose it to the network so that, well, any user on the network could connect and, well, make use of the service. To scale this up a notch, you can imagine that servers like YouTube servers or Facebook servers are exposed not just to their local network, but to the entire internet, which means remote connections from anyone around the world can hit the server and trigger off some computation. But of course, for the purposes of this discussion, we'll stick to our local network. The idea is this. In order for, well, anyone else to access the server, address binding is a notion that comes into play. Without going too deep into the networking theory, the idea is that, well, a server listens on an IP address. This is the address in which other devices on the network will use to connect to the server. Usually, these addresses are bound to the devices on the machine itself, also known as the interfaces. And yeah, basically by listening on one or more interfaces that are present on the device itself, that's how you can accept connections coming in from the outside world. It will also listen on a port number. Ports are essentially like virtual endpoints or places in which, well, devices can connect to you. This will become more important later on, but for now, just know that devices can have port numbers and they define endpoints to connect to. So how do we get a server running? The simplest way is to, well, start up a server, and have it listen at the IP address 0.0.0.0. This address basically means no particular address. In other words, it's listening to everything. Any connection and all that comes to this computer on the right port will be responded to by this server application. This is essentially the most open you can make your server go, of course, without also configuring your router so that it can accept connections from the actual internet. Yeah, essentially, your server will not pick and choose any connection, it'll accept everything it sees. On the opposite end of the spectrum, you can also start up your server to listen to 127.0.0.1. This is also known as localhost, and in other words, will only accept connections from the device itself. So yeah, while this is still a networking application, it's now only listening to connections from the same device, what is also known as a loopback. This may sound silly at the outset. Why create a server application and then make it such that nothing else on a network can actually access it? I mean, after all, we get the impression that servers are inherently multi-user, right? So why do something like this? Well, turns out, local servers are a thing. Popular software applications out there like Node-RED and JupyterNotebook are good examples of this. They essentially set up a server just so that you can actually work with the program using your web browser. So instead of having to set up some particular GUI, they just make use of web techniques so that, yeah, you get a simple cross-platform GUI that works out of the box anywhere. And, well, that's a legitimate use case. So the whole point of this discussion is to come down to this one conclusion, and that is, we like to have servers, but we want to be careful about exposing them to the internet. You can imagine that the ideal best case scenario would be to allow access only to authenticated users, that is, users who have a username and password we issue. We also want the connection to be encrypted so that no one can eavesdrop on the connection. And finally, we want things to be easy to set up. The less we have to do, the less we have to create, the better. And here's the interesting thing, we can do it ourselves, right? We can set up our own authentication on our server, we can set up SSL and so on. But one of the rules of good cybersecurity is don't roll it yourself. Instead of having to go through all that difficult stuff, wouldn't it be better if we could just ride on an existing standard that already does all these things? And the answer is yes, we can actually do that. SSH exists. We know that SSH does all these things. It has encryption, it allows you to connect and authenticate. So why can't we just, well, use SSH to do that communication? Well, there is one little snag. SSH transmits, well, SSH information, right? That is, of course, our remote control, remote viewing of the console window, and so on. So whatever else we're trying to do may not fit into this protocol. Let's say we have a web server, we want to access web pages. That's HTTP, right? That's not SSH. So how can we bring these two things together? This is where the notion of tunneling comes into play. HTTP is its own protocol, SSH is its own protocol, and so in order to carry HTTP over SSH, we need to first turn HTTP into SSH protocol packets. So that's the idea, we repackage the information so that it can actually be, well, communicated. That's the English definition of what tunneling is. To be more precise, here's how the whole notion of packaging actually works. You see, in order for these little bits of information called packets to be transmitted across a network, the packets need to have some metadata. These are what we call headers, and again, they allow the routing of these packets to, well, complete successfully. SSH has its own set of headers, HTTP has its own set of headers. So to encapsulate a HTTP packet into SSH, essentially, all you need to do is to stick the appropriate SSH headers over the HTTP packet. Of course, now that we have the correct headers in place, of course, the SSH connection, right, recognizes it as an SSH packet, it will happily transmit that along. At the endpoint, all we need to do is to strip off those headers, and what we're left with is our good old HTTP packet, with all the required HTTP headers and the body as per usual. However, what's nice about this is that the HTTP packet is now no longer moving in the clear. Because it's being transmitted across the SSH connection, it can reap all the benefits that an SSH connection can provide, namely the authentication as well as the encryption. That's why we call it a tunnel. Instead of moving in the clear, it's moving through a secret passage. And finally, we've gotten all the puzzle pieces we need, all the context or the background to discuss the actual act of doing SSH tunneling. You've already seen in the Friday Minis video, when I'm using OpenSSH, I use the command that looks something like this. Essentially, I'm telling SSH to use local port forwarding. That's their name for this SSH tunneling process. The first pair of numbers is the local IP address as well as the local port number. The next two values are the remote IP address and the remote port number. What you're saying with this option is that you want to build a tunnel between these two endpoints so that any packets that appear at this IP address gets routed to that IP address via the SSH tunnel. Of course, vice versa as well. Of course, you'll still want to put in your remote machine credentials and to key in your password as per normal. This, of course, is the authentication side of things. Here's something interesting that threw me in a loop at the beginning. You realize that I'm essentially writing 127.0.0.1 twice. How does that really make sense? 127.0.0.1 is, of course, the local host IP address. It refers to my own machine. And this whole statement makes sense because the front portion is relative to the client machine. Localhost from the point of view of the client machine refers to, well, the client itself. The second port and address pair is from the point of view of the remote device. So localhost in that context must then refer to the remote device. So even though we use the address 127.0.0.1 twice, they're referring to two very different devices. That is a little bit confusing at the beginning, but once you understand the context, then yeah, it makes sense. So yeah, once you've done this, the moment you press enter, you connect successfully, the tunnel is active. You don't even need to actually send any commands through SSH like you normally would. As long as this connection is open, you haven't, you know, exit out of the connection, then the tunnel is active. What's nice is that on the remote machine, you can now run a server on localhost, exposing that server on the port that you've mentioned earlier. Remember, this server is exposed to localhost only. That means even if I know the IP address of that device and I try to connect to it on the correct port, I'm not going to be able to see that, well, page directly, at least not from a remote device that does not have the tunnel active. So then, how do I access the page? Well, we look at the other end of the tunnel. On my client device, the tunnel has been opened locally and on this particular port. Therefore, if I try to make a connection to this port, my connection request will be forwarded through the SSH tunnel to where the server is listening. The response comes back in the same way, and suddenly, I'm accessing the remote web page via the SSH tunnel. What's cool is that from the point of view of these two machines, everything is happening locally. From your client machine, I'm just talking to the SSH process on my own machine. On the remote machine, it's the same idea. It's just communicating on a port that, well, the SSH process happens to also be listening to and communicating on. Neither of these machines realize, in fact, that they're communicating over the network. But they are, and SSH is the middleman that forwards the messages along. And yeah, that's it. That's SSH tunneling in a nutshell. As I mentioned in the Friday Minis episode, you do want to be a little bit careful about what address you put in as well. For example, if on my local machine, I bind this connection not to localhost, but to 0.0.0.0, then something interesting happens. What I'm saying now is, yes, the server is running on the remote machine on localhost, therefore it's not being exposed to the network. Forward that information to my client machine. However, my client machine makes it such that that forwarded connection can be accessed by anything on the network. That in effect exposes the server, but not from the remote device, instead from my client device itself. So that's interesting because now the remote device becomes accessible to anything on the network, but you have to key in the IP address of that client device, not of the server. I'm not sure if there are any use cases that you know, really take advantage of this. It does seem like kind of a strange way of doing things, but it is possible. Of course, this does reintroduce some of the risk of just opening up a server to the entirety of your local network, so you need to do it with understanding of the risks. To be safe, we'll stick to typing in 127.0.0.1 so that we know that everything stays on localhost. Anyway, we've rambled long enough. I hope that's enough context for this particular video. Let's go ahead and wrap things up now. SSH tunneling is a very useful way to, well, get devices to communicate with each other in a much more controlled manner than you normally could. So if you have security concerns, and yet you still need to have a server application of some kind, you may want to consider this strategy. That's it. That's all there is for this particular video. I hope you found it useful. I hope you found it interesting. But until next time, you're watching 0612TV on NERDfirst.net.
Thank you very much for watching. If you like this video and are feeling generous, a donation to this channel will be greatly appreciated. There's a link on screen and in the video description for more details. Meanwhile, please do like, comment, and subscribe. This helps the channel tremendously and gives me the means to do more. Thank you once again, and I'll see you next time.